Good afternoon, happy Sabbath, and we're going to begin our study this afternoon. And before we begin, can we have a word of prayer? Dear Father in heaven, we thank you, Lord, for the Sabbath and for the time that we have to study together. We ask, Lord, that your presence can be here through thy Spirit. We are thankful, Lord, for the things that you have been teaching us as we've been studying together. And we need your Spirit to change our hearts. We ask for forgiveness for our sins. We ask, Lord, that you can help us in the areas of our lives that we have been unwilling to yield to you. Thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Okay, so we're going to come back here. This is I was just looking at this. So this is where we're going to be reading. Let me see if I can find it. There we go. So that's the first one. Here it is. So that's where we're going to start. Though I want to finish looking at the Ellen White statement we were reading this morning. We're almost done. And that will be a bit of a review from what we looked at this morning. So this was an article called Our Need of the Spirit. From the Home Missionary, November 1st, 1893. And here we had read this morning about, or not this morning, last night, pardon me, regarding the need of the Holy Spirit and what this means. Now, there's a number of things that I want to look at, which I don't think I can do all this afternoon, but I'm going to finish off this part. Then we're going to go look at a statement by Froome, and then we're going to go to A.T. Jones' article from 1893. So I'm just going to go back and read a little bit here. Ellen White says, "We are living in the last days, when error of a most deceptive character is accepted and believed, while truth is discarded. The Lord will hold both ministers and people responsible for the light which shines in our day. God calls upon all who claim to believe present truth to work diligently in gathering up the precious jewels of truth and placing them in their position in the framework of the gospel. Let them shine in all their divine beauty and loveliness, that the light may flash forth amid the moral darkness. This cannot be accomplished without the aid of the Holy Spirit, but with the aid of the Spirit, we can do all things. When we are endowed with the Holy Spirit, we, by faith, take hold of infinite power. There is nothing to be lost of that which comes from God. The Savior of the world sends his divine messenger to the soul, that men may dig for the truth, that by its revelation they may dispel the multitude of errors. This is the Christian's work." So we can see the reference here to the work of the Holy Spirit in presenting truth, and we can see the reference here to William Miller's dream, the one with the jewel box, the casket. "The work of the Holy Spirit is immeasurably great. It is from this source that power and efficiency come to the worker for God. And the Holy Spirit is the comforter as the personal presence of Christ to the soul. He who looks to Christ in simple childlike faith is made partaker of the divine nature through the agency of the Holy Spirit. When led by the Spirit of God, the Christian may know that he is made complete in him who is the head of all things, as Christ was glorified on the day of Pentecost, so will he again be glorified in the closing work of the gospel, when he shall prepare a people to stand the final test in the closing conflict of the great controversy. So Dwight, in your reading this morning, what did Ellen White say about the day of Pentecost? Do you remember?
There was a lot that she had to say about this with the day of Pentecost.
She said something about it chronologically. What was that? Do you remember? Anybody remember?
I'd have to look back at what I was reading.
So it was dating from the day of Pentecost.
Yes, remember? Dating, yes.
Okay, so when we look back here and we look at this study dealing with the Holy Spirit being poured out on the day of Pentecost, we talked about how this is typical of the work that's going to happen at the end of the world. Even though it is a fulfillment of the prophecy of Joel, it still is typical. That is, this work that happened then is needed now. And it's in this completion of this work, at the closing work of the gospel. So we have the opening of the gospel, and we have the closing work of the gospel. So that history is being repeated. And it was also repeated in Millerite history. Because in Millerite history, we have a chronological connection to Pentecost, which Stephen has shown, which is a representation of the gospel of Christ upon the cross. But now she's going to attach this to Revelation 18. So is she here taking the history of the time of Christ, the history of the Millerites, and putting them together in our history?
She is, because it says as Christ was glorified on the day of Pentecost, so will he again be glorified in the closing work of the gospel, when he shall prepare people to stand in the final test in the closing conflict with the great controversy.
Right. And then she's referencing Miller's dream dealing with the casket. So that ties us to Millerite history as well. Right?
Right.
So we can see all three histories here as she's dealing with this work of the Holy Spirit. And of course, these are reform lines. These are great reformatory movements. The time of Christ, of course, the time of the Millerites, and then the final closing work. So in all of those, the work of the Holy Spirit is extremely important. It cannot be accomplished without it. And when she says, when the earth is lightened with the glory of God, we shall see a work similar to that which was wrought when the disciples filled with the Holy Spirit proclaimed the power of a risen Savior. The light of heaven penetrated the darkened minds of those who had been deceived by the enemies of Christ, and the false representation of him was rejected. For through the efficacy of the Holy Spirit, they now saw him exalted to be a prince and savior, to give repentance unto Israel and remission of sins. Christ was glorified through the power of the Holy Spirit resting upon men. So this is true in the time of Christ, and this will be true in our time. The revelation of Christ by the Holy Spirit brought to them a realizing sense of his power and majesty, and they stretched forth their hands unto him by faith, saying, I believe. Thus it was in the time of the early reign. But the latter reign will be more abundant. The Savior of men will be glorified, and the earth will be lightened with the bright shining of the beams of his righteousness. He is the fountain of light, and light from the gates ajar has been shining upon the people of God, that they may lift him up in his glorious character before those who sit in darkness. So again, that illustration that she has of the first and second angels' messages, the Millerite movement, where you see light shining in the darkness. And of course, that's a basic principle of a reform line, that you have darkness, and then you have a message that gives an increase of light. It is Christ in his fullness as a sin-pardoning Savior that the sinner must see. So this is a revelation of Christ. This is the mare. For the unparalleled love of Christ through the agency of the Holy Spirit will bring conviction and conversion to the hardened heart. Is this not a revival and reformation?
Absolutely.
Oh, that we as a people might humble our hearts before God and plead with him for the endowment of the Holy Spirit. So this is, and the reason we read this article is that A.T. Jones quotes the beginning of this article as his text for his study for several days that he's going to be doing. And in this study, he's going to be addressing some history that he has recently been a part of that has to do with the Chicago World's Fair or the World's Columbian Exhibition. We're going to go. But before we go there, I want to go to something by Froome. And this is... Where did it go? Did I accidentally close it? I must have. Just hang on. Disappeared. Oh, I know why. It's in here. Sorry about that. It's in my other browser. Okay, so let's go there. Now, Leroy Froome did a series in 1928, which was published as a book called The Coming of the Comforter. Here, I'll show it here. Now, how many people, I guess you can raise your hand using this program. I can't remember how you do it, but how do you raise your hand?
Reactions.
What's that?
Reactions. Down at the bottom of the screen, it says reactions.
Okay. Yeah. So I want people to raise their hands. How many people have read the book, The Coming of the Comforter by Froome? So. Okay. So, William, did you?
I didn't read it. I was just mucking around with it.
Okay.
As usual.
Okay. So you didn't read it. Has anybody read it? Maybe you can answer verbally if anybody's read it.
If I did, it would have been over 20 years ago, and I don't remember.
Yeah. Well, I read it in 1984. Maybe early 85, so that was a while ago, but I remember it quite well. And you can see it here. This is his introduction. And now what he's presenting is not Adventist understanding. He's presenting a neo-Pentecostal understanding of the Holy Spirit. Now here's what he says, how he prepared for these studies. So it says, in preparation for these studies, following a close survey of every text in the Bible on the Holy Spirit, I read every reference there to in the 23 volumes of the Spirit of Prophecy, as well as many articles appearing in the past in our denominational journals from the pen of Mrs. E.G. White. So he read from the Bible in the Spirit of Prophecy. Then he says, from this encompassing array of material, the outstanding statements and principles were selected. They appear scattered through the studies. These were taken as the guide and standard in studying further some 50 volumes on the Holy Spirit, representing the choicest gems written in modern times, and scanning many more as collateral reading. Thus were formed the three divisions of this volume: on the promise, the coming, and the filling of the Spirit. So what is he saying in regard to his study? Where has his understanding come from?
From other studies, it looks like.
Okay, so he does have the Bible and the Spirit of Prophecy, which he says he studied. But he studied 50 volumes written in modern times.
That's right.
So would these be Adventist studies?
Probably not.
No. So, and then, of course, scanning many more as collateral reading. So he has done his research. Has he followed Miller's rules in doing this?
No.
Because what has he done? How would we characterize how he has approached this topic?
He's gone by the principles of men more than what scriptures is saying.
Right. So, I mean, he starts with the Bible, and that's good.
Mm-hmm.
And then he uses the Spirit of Prophecy. But he's going to filter those through what he reads by modern writers. Why even go to the modern writers at all?
To be in vogue?
Well, you know, he's got to get the most recent information. This reminds me of the rabbinic Jews. So the scriptures are good, you know, for a child. And as you get older, you become more discerning. You can read, of course, the various rabbinic writings. And as you get older, you start to read the commentaries on the commentary, right? So the Talmud, the Babylonian and the Jerusalem Talmud, and then the Mishnah, which is a commentary on the Talmud. And so you become acquainted with the most recent information to become informed. And that's the approach that he's using. He's not going back to the foundation. He's looking at it, but it's going to be filtered by what he has read later. And you would see this in reading this. So I'm not going to go through this book, but I do want to note that when Ellen White talks about the Holy Spirit and his work, there is a counterfeit that exists within Adventism. And people have a hard time discerning the difference. That is, most Adventists would read this book by Froome and find it no problem with it. They wouldn't find any problems with what he has said. They would probably find it enlightening. But it's not presenting what Ellen White presents or what the Bible presents about the work of the Holy Spirit. And of course, I'm not going to take the time to show you that, but I want you at least to be aware of it. Now, we're going to go to Jones' statements here. And of course, Jones is quoting Ellen White. The people who will now see what is soon to come upon us by what is being transacted before us will no longer trust in human inventions and will feel that the Holy Spirit must be recognized, received, and presented before the people. So Jones says, tonight, to begin with, and to lay the foundation for what is to come, we will look at the situation as it exists tonight before us in the United States government. And for this reason, I shall relate the experiences of the hearing that took place lately in Washington, beginning with that, and simply state the facts as they are before us tonight. And then afterward, we can find out the bearing of the facts that already exist. So he's going to be dealing with this idea of this religious legislation. When the first movement was made for religious legislation by Congress in the United States, you will remember that we began to circulate a petition which was in effect a remonstrance against anything of the kind containing these words. To the Honorable the Senate of the United States, we the undersigned, adult residents of the United States, 21 years of age or more, hereby respectfully but earnestly petition your honorable body not to pass any bill in regard to the observance of the Sabbath or the Lord's Day or any other religious or ecclesiastical institution or rite, nor to favor in any way the adoption of any resolution for the amendment of the National Constitution that would in any way tend, either directly or indirectly, to give preference to the principles of any religion or of any religious body above another, or that will in any way sanction legislation upon the subject of religion, but that the total separation between religion and state, assured by the National Constitution as now is, may forever remain as our fathers established it. Now, of course, this is a little bit more wordy than if we signed a petition today. So this is going to be regarding the World's Fair. And the Sunday closing of the World's Fair, when that came up, this was likewise brought before Congress under this protest. So this is another petition. We, the undersigned citizens of the United States, hereby respectfully but decidedly protest against the Congress of the United States committing the United States government to a union of religion and the state in the passage of any bill or resolution to close the World's Columbian Exposition on Sunday, or in any other way committing the government to a course of religious legislation. The Breckinridge Bill, so this is... So he's now, that's the one petition and the other. Now, this first one, and I haven't had enough time to research it, but I think he would be talking about the Blair Bill here with this petition. So that was in 1888. And then 5 years later, you're going to have this bill by Breckinridge, the Breckinridge Bill. So it was protested against in the same way. This bill to stop the delivery of ice on Sunday. So this might be different last year in Congress. So this might be a different bill. So I'm not quite sure. I'm not familiar with these. So they were trying to stop the delivery of ice. So this is the Breckinridge Bill. You have the World's Fair issue. I can't remember who brought that up. And then I think this is referring to the Blair Bill, but I could be wrong. But Jones at this time is actively working in the area of religious liberty. Now, is this, or could we see what Jones is doing? Is it political?
I'd have to say no, not really. Okay.
So we have had people handing out petitions. I mean, we had petitions sent to us by email, and people suggesting that we sign these petitions. And this was regarding... So what would be the difference here? Signing a petition about Sunday or signing a petition about... And it looks like Chris is doing that again to my, he's drawing lines all over this.
It's not me this time.
Not you this time, eh? So somebody else is doing that.
Yep.
How are they doing that?
I don't know.
You know, the only reason I asked is because my computer's been acting up.
Yeah, I don't know how that happens, but anyway, so what would be the difference, or is there a difference?
I'm not sure there is a difference.
Okay, well, I think there is quite a bit of a difference between the two. Is there anything partisan about what Jones is doing with this petition?
Not really.
Like, is he
is cut and dry, I think.
Yeah, so he's not referring to any sort of political party. It's not politically motivated in any way.
No, just citizens over the age of 21.
Yeah. Is is what had been happening with the pandemic and the, is that a political?
Well, it depends on what you're talking about. I mean, is it political to as me as a person don't want to have to take something that somebody else says I have to?
Okay, well, that's fine. But we know that the issue is a political one.
That is, well, it appears that way in the public.
Right. It is. And if you're a Democrat, you're going to have a different view than if you're a Republican or a conservative than a liberal, right?
Right. But if I make a petition to not have this thing done, me and say 500,000 people sign this petition that we don't want to have the government tell us what to do in that respect with our health.
Mm-hmm.
Now, yep. Is that political?
Okay. Anybody else on this?
I'm just asking. Is that political?
Yeah.
It has to do with our health, and I don't think it's political.
Whether we're forcing the conscience regarding Sunday or it's still a violation of our human rights and God-given rights and our conscience.
Okay.
So
is Jones, in any of the things Jones doing, is he trying to support a right? Because would it matter to A.T. Jones whether the World's Fair is opened or closed on Sunday from a personal point of view?
Him?
Yeah.
I wouldn't think so from a personal point of view. He wouldn't. I don't think he would personally go.
Right. So he's not going to. Well, he's not going to go to the World's Fair at all, right?
Right, pretty much.
It's not a place for a Christian to be. So his interest in this is not a personal interest in the sense of nothing about the World's Fair is affecting him directly.
Right.
Right?
Right. I get that.
Yeah. So he's standing up for a principle of the Constitution, not for his own personal rights. That is, he's standing up for the rights of others. Again, this is about just Sunday closing. Now, he would do the same thing if it was being closed on the Sabbath.
Right.
Right. So, I mean, in some ways, a lot of people aren't going to be affected by it. But he sees that there's a principle involved here, that the United States government, and especially with the Blair Bill, is seeking to control an issue which is the Sunday law. Right? This is connected to the Sunday law. Now, does a Christian stand up and fight for his rights?
Theodore, I'm finding it hard to understand.
What's hard to understand?
Well, you're saying that is a right. Is that what you're saying? Is it a right for them to come and give us?
No, I never said anything like that. I'm asking about, does a Christian stand up for his rights? Did Christ stand up for his rights?
What do you mean? I mean, did he not have a sermon now that I think about it, I don't think I've ever heard of him.
Well, let me ask it. Can I ask it in this way? So it is wrong for us to say, if the government was forcing me to worship on Sunday, that would be a right for me, right? It would be, it's a violation of my conscience.
Yeah, and are you going to stand up for your rights?
where when it comes to the Sunday law, I'm going to stand up for him, right?
Okay. So what are you going to do then?
I'm not going to do nothing as far as politically.
Okay.
But wouldn't it be on the same lines because it's a violation of the health laws?
Okay. So what we have to distinguish here is the principles that are involved.
Right. Yeah, I imagine so.
So when it comes to, I'm not going to get a
right.
When it comes to the Sunday Sabbath issue, I'm going to keep the Sabbath. But am I going to try to change the government's mind regarding these issues? Well, and if I do so, how am I going to do that?
What did Daniel do? He didn't fight what happened to him.
Mm-hmm.
He went into the lion's cage, but you know, maybe he had no choice, you know. I mean, he didn't run. He didn't fight. That was Daniel. At mm-hmm. least it doesn't say anything about him running or fighting. He accepted what was going on.
So that means we have to accept?
No.
No, quite, I would say no.
Quite the opposite. So
I'm sorry, Theodore. This you're saying that we don't accept the Sunday law, but if it's a violation of our health, we can't speak out against it. Is that what
I said? Anything about not speaking out against something?
Oh, okay.
I'm just saying, do we fight for our rights?
And what do you mean, define fight?
Okay, so am I going to be signing petitions, going on protests, lobbying the government? And am I going to be caught up in what's happening around me? Or am I going
No, we won't. We won't be signing no petitions, and we won't be protesting the government like that.
Well, what did this other person do here? I mean, we signed this thing and we're over 21 and we're protesting. Now that's the only way that I could actually see the protest going is in that manner. I can't physically try to make them comply, you know. All I can do is give them my opinion and be as passionate as I possibly can about it without, you know, hurting anybody. Because the idea is to not to be hurt. If you're going to try to hurt somebody, then that's doing the exact opposite, you know, trying to use the opposite explanation to get what you want. And that's not what we do, or we shouldn't be doing. I mean, Jeremiah what happened with him? I mean, there's all kinds of these examples of people that had things happen to them.
Right. So when they're dealing with their own personal selves, they're going to just follow their conscience, no matter the consequences.
Right.
Right.
All right.
Now, the question here is what Jones was doing, was that the correct way to approach it? I mean, I'm asking the question. Was he being political in these petitions?
I don't think he was being political. He also didn't want to have politics enforced onto him.
Okay, what do you mean?
Well, if somebody's... Okay, so whatever it is that they want you to do, it's because that they've come and they've asked you, did you want to participate in this? And you said yes. No, somebody's telling you to do something. So to me, it takes politics in order to make it happen. But necessarily, it's not politics if you're trying to, you know, express your feelings. Oh man.
Can we take it like this? Let's the homosexuality. Let's put it this way. Our kids are now being shoved down their throat with homosexuality, right?
Not if they're not in school.
That's right, not if they're not in school. But I'm talking about the ones who are in school.
Okay, so let's leave that topic alone. So
okay.
Because you're just gonna muddy the water here.
Okay.
Because you're looking at something that's quite different.
How is it forcing somebody to take and homosexual community forcing their ideas down our kids?
Okay.
How's that different?
Well, I mean, it's not the same thing at all. So, I mean, they're not even in the same ballpark. And I don't know what you mean by forcing. I mean, I haven't seen anybody forced to take yet.
People not yet.
Pressured. But nobody who's not wanted to take has been forced to do so.
Maybe I'm sorry. Yeah, I'm thinking.
Not yet.
I apologize.
Yeah. So anyway, so let's read what he says here. So we'll try to get this. What Jones is getting to is he's getting to Revelation 13. That's where he's leading us. Right. While we were circulating these petitions, men would not believe that there was enough of importance in it to sign their names to the petitions. Even when they believed that the petition was all right in itself, men would admit that was all right. They would say, I believe all that, but it's not enough importance to pay any attention to. I would not take the time to sign my name to it, although I am in favor of all you are saying. No such thing as that will ever be done. And because there were so many of that kind of people who did not believe that it would ever be done, it was done. And when they found out it was done, they began to try to have it undone. They began to wake up to see that they were mistaken and that it had been done. And then seeing their mistake, they began trying to retrieve it by asking that the World's Fair should be open on Sunday. And the reasons they urge for the opening of the fair are precisely the same reasons that were given for closing it. So this is an interesting point that he's going to bring out. So we have to read through this to try to understand what was happening. This movement for opening originated in Chicago. The Chicago Herald started it. And the City Council of Chicago took it up and drafted a memorial to Congress, which the City Council, with the mayor at its head, as representatives from the City of Chicago, took to Washington and presented the first day of the 4 days hearing. Some of the reasons that were given upon which they asked that the fair should be opened on Sunday, I will read. That the gates of the World's Columbian Exposition be not closed Sunday, that all machinery be stopped and that noise be suppressed that day to the end that quiet may prevail, which is in keeping with the Sabbath. That recognizes Sunday as the Sabbath. And of course, there is a certain quiet that becomes it. And they wanted it open with the machinery stopped, that the quiet may prevail. That is the same reason that the other folks want to shut it on Sunday. They want the same thing. That suitable accommodations be provided within the exposition grounds for holding religious services the Sabbath day to the end that all the denominations may have worship conducted according to their several customs without obstruction or hindrance. Again, Jones says that is the same reason that the other folks wanted it shut so that it could have religious services in their churches. We recognize and rejoice in the fact that our country is and always has been a Christian nation. Jones says, and the leading reason urged by the churches for closing it is that this is a Christian nation. And then they go on, we are of the opinion that more goodwill will be accomplished by permitting these people and all others who desire it to visit the inside of the grounds than will follow from keeping them out. We believe that the United States as a Christian country should open the gates Sunday as a recognition of the fact that in no branch of human interest or thought has there been more progress during that 400 years of time than in the Christian church? Jones says that is exactly the reason that all the other folks gave for shutting it, that the United States as a nation should shut the fair on Sunday as a recognition of the advancement made in Christian ideas. Would it not be a good thing to throw the sanctity of religious worship about the great temple dedicated to the things of use and beauty? That's what they say. And Jones says the reason given for shutting the fair was that it would be a good thing to throw the sanctity of religion over the whole fair. So you can see the reasons that were given for opening it are precisely the reasons that were given for shutting it. So the fact that the fair was open on Sundays instead of being closed, did that really change anything from the principles that Jones had been addressing?
Jones was using a constitutional argument as far as his basis, and the Constitution was written for everybody, so that's what he's basically pointing out.
Yeah, so they're not going to make a constitutional argument, are they?
No, they're doing it on feelings.
Yeah, they're giving reasons why something is better than something else.
Right. I feel that because of this, you should do that.
Yeah. So the principles are still the same principles because the reasons are the same reasons.
Right. Okay. I agree.
And this is the problem that we face when we get involved in political issues that have been politicized. You know, for instance, we're all opposed to abortion.
Yes, I mean, I am.
Now, when it comes to pro-life protests, are we involved in those?
No.
No.
Why not?
No, we're not.
Well, it's not about shouting. It's not about standing in front of somebody trying to make a choice, or that's made a choice, whichever.
We can do that naturally by how we live our lives. We don't need to stand on a street corner and scream or yell or have signs.
Okay, but the real reason, what's the real reason we don't get involved in the pro-life movement? Because what's behind the pro-life movement?
As Christians, we're not supposed to be political.
Well, it's politics behind the pro-life.
Okay, well, it's more than just politics. Is it not the Catholic Church behind it?
Oh, yeah, right.
And we can see that the same people who are pro-life, are they not also pro-Sunday?
Yes.
Right, yeah. Okay.
So you
the
can
majority
see,
of them are.
So you can see the dangers of becoming entangled with the world, even on an issue that we believe to be correct, that it's not as straightforward as it looks on the surface.
The only thing we could do is educate, you know, neighbors and friends and such, you know.
Right. I mean, there's no problem with education. There's no problem with letting your voice be heard. But in an alignment with those who are
opposed to you,
no. Ultimately, who would not seek your good when it came to other issues, I think is a danger.
It's like most people, they are for the Second Amendment of the United States Constitution, but when it comes to the First Amendment, under the religious, it says, Congress shall make no law respecting or the establishment of religion. They would go along with making a law to force you to worship on a certain day.
Okay. So let's, this is from the Chicago Tribune. It's in mentioning the letter that Cardinal Gibbons wrote on the subject, introduced in this form in this issue of December 3rd, 1892. There is a strong and growing sentiment in some religious circles in favor of the repeal of the World's Fair Sunday Closing Act. One eminent divine after another is coming out in favor of this liberal movement. The possibilities for a series of religious demonstrations at the park become more and more manifest. With the leading religious and moral teachers of Europe and America to conduct services every Sunday, the sacred music produced by choruses, embracing perhaps thousands of trained voices. Sunday at the World's Fair will be one of the grandest recognitions of the Sabbath known to modern history. So he says, so the other folk said, if the fair be closed on Sunday and the solemnity of the Sabbath overspreads it, and this nation sets the grand example of the recognition of the Sabbath, it will be one of the grandest exhibitions, of the Sabbath known to modern history. More than this, those who worked for the opening of the fair pandered to the church interests precisely as the others did in working for the shutting of it. As soon as these things appeared in print, I wrote to Brother A. Moon, sending him these marked passages, and I said to him, you can readily see that the reasons that are given by these people for opening the fair are precisely the same, precisely the reasons they were given, that were given for shutting it. Now, that being so, for us to join with them would be to recognize the legitimacy of the legislation and the reasons for the legislation, whereas every one of these reasons is directly against everything that we have been working for all these years in Congress. So this makes it plain enough that we cannot put a single one of our petitions along with theirs. We cannot take a single step along with them. We cannot work with them at all or connect with them in any way in the way they are working or upon the reasons which they give for opening the fair. We will have to maintain the position that the legislation is not and never was right at all. The only thing we can do, therefore, is to hold that the thing ought to be undone. The only position which we can take is that the Sunday part of the legislation should be unconditionally repealed. So do you see the problem of signing someone else's petition?
Yes.
Okay. So we can see that these things are politicized, that the reason what we are doing is binding ourselves with a sentiment that we can't possibly agree with as Seventh-day Adventists. No matter how much we recognize the problems that have existed, we as Seventh-day Adventists have a different path that we have to follow.
So what you're essentially saying is that what this demonstration is that if we are going to protest, we're going to protest on the fact that the legislation shouldn't be done, and also to not assemble or to sign on to anybody else's petitions because of those reasons.
Yeah, because we don't join with the world, because we don't look at things the same way the world does.
Yeah, we're a peculiar people.
Mm-hmm.
So we would have to be, if something like that was to be done, and we would be doing it in a manner that it would just be the movement itself that was a part of that would sign on to that, not necessarily sign on to somebody else's stuff, but we would have our own slant as a way of saying it. We would have our own slant on it.
Yeah, because what the church was presenting in their petition was appeal to the Constitution, to the principles. But the world isn't interested in those principles. So, you know, when we look at the problems that exist in the world today, the Christian church seeks the power of the state when it loses the power of the gospel, correct?
Correct.
And we as Christians, we have something more powerful than the state. We have the gospel. The gospel is the
right.
How do we attack homosexuality? Are we going to bring in legislation to bring up what William was talking about? To stop all these things happening?
No, we have the gospel to use.
We only have the gospel. That's the power. We have something more powerful than the power of the state, and that's the power of the gospel. And if we seek the power of the state, we become bound to that power.
Right?
Better than them.
Yeah. It's like entering into a covenant.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. Now, I don't know how many people, you know, watching this or how many of you would have signed a petition regarding the pandemic, but I think a lot of us would really like to have signed one, even if we didn't. mean, we didn't like to see what was happening. And what about even appealing to the church itself? Would we protest to the church by some petition that people made?
Well, there were those going around.
Yeah. Are we going to change the church?
No.
By petition?
No. It doesn't appear that way.
Would it
change the church?
Yeah, would it accomplish anything?
No.
Sorry about that.
In fact, it doesn't help anything in any situation to sign a petition.
Because if it's true that the power of the gospel is what's going to change people, then it's really the gospel that we should be using. That is the power of the Holy Spirit to convict and to convert.
It's agreeable.
Mm-hmm. So what power do we trust? There's nothing wrong with a protest of principles to point out to others where they are straying from the principles of either the Constitution or the principles of God's law or whatever. But to seek the power of the state, and see, the whole point of this petition wasn't so much, in my understanding of it, to stop something. It was to make them aware of something. They wanted to be heard. Jones and the church wanted to be heard by the government so that they could point out what direction they were tending. That was the primary reason.
So you're saying that it was a reminder that where we came from.
Yeah. To set for the what the principles were involved.
That's right.
Yeah. And Jones makes this really clear in his presentations.
Yes, he does.
So Brother Moon immediately replied that he had seen these statements and had already taken the position that I spoke of in my letter. You will remember that about the same time I wrote an article which appeared in the Sentinel, that's the American Sentinel, setting forth the same facts and taking the same position, saying that we did not care to a turn of hand whether the fair was opened or shut on Sunday, but we did care more than could be told whether the subject should be dealt with at all by Congress. Therefore, Brother Moon told the chairman of the committee and the gentlemen who were managing that side of the question in Washington that neither we nor our petitions could be counted at all in connection with that movement. The chairman of the committee asked Brother Moon what our position was. He told the committee what our position was and how many petitions there were there. Of course, all the names that were gathered upon the first petition, nearly 400,000, are just as good today as they were then, whenever any congressman chooses to call them up and present them. They are everlastingly against the whole thing. Therefore, the chairman, when Brother Moon told him what our position was and the reason for it, said to him, "You write out your position as regards this legislation, and I will present it as a bill in the House so as to give you a basis upon which to present your petitions and for your arguments to be heard." Brother Moon, in that room, dictated to Mr. Thompson of Chicago what we desired, and the chairman, Durborough, introduced it with his own name on it. Following is the bill. So this was the 52nd Congress, the second session, and it says, "In the House of Representatives, December 20th, 1892, referred to the Select Committee on the Columbian Exposition and ordered to be printed, Mr. Durborough introduced the following joint resolution. Joint resolution to repeal the religious legislation pertaining to the World's Columbian Exposition. Whereas the United States Constitution specifically states that Congress shall make no laws respecting an establishment of religion, or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. Therefore, be it resolved by the House and Senate, and by the Senate and House of Representatives of the United States of America in Congress assembled, that the Act of Congress approved August 5th, 1892, appropriating 5 millions of Colombian half dollars to provide for celebrating the 400th anniversary of the discovery of America by Christopher Columbus, by holding an international exposition of arts, industries, and manufactures and products of the soil, mine, and sea in the city of Chicago in the state of Illinois on the condition that the said exposition shall not be open to the public on the first day of the week, commonly called Sunday, and also that Section 4 of an Act to aid in carrying out the Act of Congress approved April 25th, 1890, entitled An Act to Provide for Celebrating the 400th Anniversary of the Discovery of America by Christopher Columbus by holding an international exposition of the arts, etc. And the same is hereby amended so as to leave the matter of Sunday observance entirely within the power of the regularly constituted authorities of the World's Columbian Exposition. That means they could decide whether they wanted to be open or closed on Sunday. That wouldn't be an issue. The issue was whether the government was going to go against the Constitution. That being understood, that was introduced with the understanding and for the express purpose of opening the way for us to present our petitions and to be heard upon the question, we proceeded upon that idea. The arrangement for the hearing was made. Brother Moon tells me that if the hearing could have been had before Christmas, he is perfectly satisfied that we would have been heard. But the hearing was not appointed until after the holidays, and Congress took a recess during the holidays. And when Congress reconvened, it was discovered that the chairman of the committee was another man altogether. I was informed that I had dinner with Elliot F. Shepard in the meantime. Whether that had any effect upon his digestion or some other part of his makeup, I do not know. At any rate, that or something caused him to repudiate all he had done and shut out the principle which he had embodied in that resolution and presented in order that we might be heard. Dr. Lewis, the Seventh-day Baptist, went to Congress to be heard. He told me that he went to Mr. Durboro, the chairman of the committee, and asked to be heard. Mr. Durboro asked him what he represented and what his argument was to be. Mr. Lewis told him that it would be upon the point of unconstitutionality of the legislation already taken by Congress. Mr. Durboro told him that the committee had decided not to hear any arguments at all upon the principle, but only upon the policy of the legislation, not to consider any question at all as to whether it was constitutional or not, but that Congress had done it, and it was presumed that Congress had the right to do it. And any mention as to the propriety of the legislation would be entirely left out. And it was only considered now as whether it would be a better policy for the country to open the fair or to shut it on the Sunday that had been adopted by Congress. When that was done, Dr. Lewis had nothing at all to say and made no calculation to say anything. But the third day, and among the last minutes of the day, Mr. Durboro called upon him to speak, giving him 5 minutes. Dr. Lewis told him that he did not have anything to say, that he did not have his documents with them, and that he had no intention to speak under the circumstances. But Mr. Durboro rather insisted that he should, that he had 5 minutes to occupy if he chose. So he occupied them through a rather perfunctory way. Samuel P. Putnam was there for the same purpose, having several thousand of petitions in his pocket. He is the president of the Free Thought Federation of America. He went to Mr. Durboro for a portion of time to be appointed him, and he received the same information, that any arguments as to the constitutionality of the question or the principle involved was not to be considered at all, but only the policy of the legislation. That being so, Mr. Putnam made no further request, but he likewise was called upon to speak, but was given only a very few minutes, which he occupied as best he could. I did not get there long enough beforehand to find all that out. Brother Moon knew it, and I did not have the chance to talk with him. My train, and I arrived there in time by hurrying to get to the committee room as the argument was opened, so I did not have time to learn anything about the situation at all. After the hearing, Mr. Thompson of Chicago came to me and asked me if I would take the balance of the time that day, the last half hour. I had written to Brother Moon that whatever arrangements they should make, I would conform to when I got there. I suppose that was the arrangement. I told Mr. Thompson if they thought best, I would speak that day, but I would like to wait until after the American Sabbath Union had spoken. But if they would rather, I would take the time. And so when I began on the only thing I knew. It was to call in question the legislation, but that was the thing they had decided not to have discussed. I noticed immediately that they were restless. The chairman was very restless, but I did not know what was the matter. So I will take up the question right there now. It is true that the chairman made a statement in opening the hearing that I understood now, but did not then. He said, the meeting today will be held for the purpose of giving a hearing to those favoring the legislation that is before the committee. I think it would be proper to state to the committee that the present case is somewhat different from the case as presented a year ago, and that the proposition before the committee is to modify existing law, not create law, as was the proposition a year ago. Therefore, the discussion before the committee on this occasion, it is expected, will be held very closely within the lines of modification presented in the resolution before the committee, copies of which are on the desk, which can be furnished to you, which provides for the modification of the closing of the gates of the Columbian Exposition on Sunday by permitting them to be opened under restrictions as stated in these resolutions. That expression, not to create law, was the statement that I did not understand then, but do now. Well, it was fortunate in another sense that I spoke that half hour, because there was no time afterward when I could have had a half hour. The longest time occupied by anybody after that was about 25 minutes, and the most of the 57 speakers had only an average of about 10 minutes allowed them. Although the chairman shut out the argument I was making upon the Constitution, yet other members of the committee asked questions until the whole half hour was consumed, and every one of their questions was presented in such a way that I was compelled to strike the Constitution and the unconstitutionality of what they had done in answering the questions. And so the argument they wanted to shut out was presented in spite of the efforts of the chairman, and the very things that he refused to listen to from us were presented by others in a great deal stronger way than we should or could have stated them. My argument before the committee is as follows. Mr. Durbow says, you have just 30 minutes left, Mr. Jones. Jones replies, Mr. Chairman, I expect to speak in favor of this legislation that is now before the committee for a larger number of reasons than could be given in the half hour which I may have to speak, but I shall endeavor to touch upon such reasons as have not been dwelt upon very particularly hitherto. I shall start with one that has been touched by Mayor Washburn to some extent, but which may be referred to a little more fully, and then I shall go from that to the consideration of other points. My first point is that this subject of whether the gates of the World's Fair shall be closed or open on Sundays is a subject with which the national government has nothing at all to do. It is entirely beyond its jurisdiction in any sense whatever. There are three distinct considerations. I do not see what that has to do with the question. Mr. Jones, Mr. Durbow, the gentleman certainly has the right to ask the question. Mr. Jones, very well. I beg your pardon. I did not know that the gentleman was a member of the committee. I'm perfectly willing to answer the question, though I cannot see what bearing it has upon this discussion. I'm a member of the Seventh-day Adventist Church, but I speak here today as a citizen of the United States and upon the principles of the government of the United States. And I may say further that in the way that Congress has touched this question, I may probably speak upon it as a Seventh-day Adventist. As Congress has entered the field of religion already, we have the right to follow it there, if necessity should require. What I was about to say is that three distinct considerations in the Constitution of the United States forbid Congress to touch this question. The first is well defined by George Bancroft in a letter which he wrote Dr. Philip Schaff, August 30th, 1887, which reads as follows. My dear Mr. Schaff, I have yours of the 12th. By the Constitution, no power is held by Congress except such as shall have been granted to it. Congress, therefore, from the beginning was as much without the power to make a law respecting the establishment of religion as it is now after the amendment has been passed. The power had not been granted and therefore did not exist, for Congress has no powers except such as are granted. But a feeling had gone abroad that there should have been a Bill of Rights, and therefore, to satisfy the craving, a series of articles were framed in the nature of the Bill of Rights, not because such a declaration was needed, but because the people wished to see certain principles distinctly put forward as a part of the Constitution. The First Amendment, so far as it relates to an establishment of religion, was proposed without passion, accepted in the several states without passion, and so found its place in the opening words of the amendments in the quietest manner possible. So that's George Bancroft. This is shown by the 10th Amendment to the Constitution, which says that the powers not delegated to the United States by the Constitution, nor prohibited by it to the states, are reserved to the states respectively, or to the people. As no power has been granted to Congress on the subject of religion, that is reserved to the states or to the people. That is where we ask that this shall be left, just where the Constitution has left it. It is a question reserved to the states. It is for the state of Illinois alone, so far as any state can have anything to say upon the subject, to say whether the fair shall be opened or shut on Sunday. If the state of Illinois should not say anything on the subject, it is still left with the people. It is for the people in their own capacity as such to act as they please in the matter, without any interference or dictation by Congress. Not only is that so on that point, but if the Constitution had not said a word on the subject of religion, there would have been no power in Congress to touch this question. But the people have spoken, the Constitution has spoken, and denied the right of the United States government to touch the question, and has reserved that right to the states or to the people. Not only did it do that, but it went further and actually prohibited the government of the United States from touching the question. This lack of power would have been complete and total without the prohibition, because the powers not delegated are reserved. But they went further and not only reserved the power, but expressly prohibited Congress from exercising it. It is trebly unconstitutional for Congress to touch the question. It was so at the beginning of the government, and this is why we insist that this legislation shall be undone and leave it where the Constitution has left it, to the states or to the people. And then Mr. Hooks says, the language of the Constitution, I believe, is that Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion. And Jones replies, I am going to follow this question a little further and notice that amendment. The amendment does not read, as it is often misquoted, Congress shall make no law respecting the establishment of religion, but Congress shall make no law respecting an establishment of religion or prohibiting the free exercise thereof. There are two meanings in this clause. When the Constitution was made, all that it said upon the subject was that no religious test shall ever be required as a qualification to any office or public trust under the United States. Some of the states had established religions at the time, I think all except Virginia. And Virginia had released herself in a campaign directly touching this question. The first part of the clause was intended to prohibit Congress from making any law respecting any of these religions which were established already in those states. And the second part of the clause prohibits Congress from touching the subject of religion on its own part in any way. In the state of Virginia, 1776, with the exception of the interval when the war was highest, to December 26, 1787, there was a campaign conducted over the same question that is now involved in this legislation. The English Church was the established church in Virginia, and the Presbyterians, the Quakers, and the Baptists sent a memorial to the General Assembly of Virginia, asking that as the colonies had declared themselves free and independent of British rule in civil things, so the state of Virginia should declare itself free from British rule in religious things, and that they should not be taxed to support a religion which they did not believe, nor even any religion which they did believe, and the English Church was disestablished. Then a movement was made to establish the Christian religion and to legislate in favor of the Christian religion by passing a bill establishing a provision for teachers of that religion. Madison and Jefferson took the opposition to that bill and by vigorous efforts defeated it, and in its place secured the passage of a bill establishing religious freedom in Virginia, which is the model of all the state constitutions from that day to this on the subject of religion in the state. So we can see here Jones is going through some of this history of what it means for there to be religious liberty, the principles that are involved here, and how this was actually worked out in the United States. Now, I'm going to skip some of this because, I mean, this is interesting, I know, but So Mr. Durbo is going to ask, your objections are simply constitutional, which is kind of an interesting question, because simply constitutional. And of course, that is his argument. So when Jones is arguing in favor of, and we're going to address this point is important. I'm going to read this response to this question. There are some others, but the foundation of all is the unconstitutionality of it. Those who sent up the petitions here and those who worked for the movement in this capital knew that it was unconstitutional when they asked it. A gentleman who spent 6 months at this capital for this legislation has argued for more than 25 years in print and in speech that any Sunday legislation by Congress or legislation in behalf of the Christian Sabbath would be unconstitutional. And yet he worked here 6 months to get Congress to do that without any change in the Constitution. For 25 years, he, with the association of which he belongs, has been working to get an amendment to the Constitution recognizing the Christian religion and making this a Christian nation, in quotation marks, so that there would be a constitutional basis for Sunday legislation. But now, in the face of that 25 years history and work, and in the face of their own arguments, they have gone right ahead and got Congress to do it when they knew it was unconstitutional. Another reason why we asked the repeal of it is that it was secured upon false representations. The representations which they made to Congress in order to secure this legislation were all false. They represented before Congress that the mass of the people of the United States were in favor of their cause, which had been demonstrated over and over to be false. It was forcibly demonstrated in the city of Chicago not quite a month ago. There, the American Sabbath Union held a convention, a national convention. They had four mass meetings the first night of the time in which the convention was held. One of those mass meetings I attended, it was reported in the Chicago papers, of which I have copies here. I will read the Chicago report of it so that it will be seen that I have not put any of my feelings into it. The Chicago Tribune of December 14, 1892 had this report. The American Sabbath Union suffered a defeat last night at one of its meetings, which so surprised the leaders present that the incident was a veritable sensation. It was an unexpected blow, and the more grievous because it was administered by one of the most Sabbatarian of all Christian denominations. Jones goes on, this was not the first instance of the kind, as some present here will remember. The union opened a national convention here yesterday afternoon and made arrangements for four mass meetings throughout the city last night to forward the movement. One of these meetings was held at the ME Church, South Park Avenue and 33rd Street. It was a small mass meeting, but everything went on smoothly for a time, and the American Sabbath had everything on its own way. And Dr. H.H. George, a leader of the movement, Mr. Locke, and others advocated the closing of the World's Fair on Sunday, and vigorously denounced the efforts of the directors and of the mayor and city council to have Congress repeal the closing act. These speeches were warmly, if not unanimously, approved by frequent amens and clapping of hands. No one looked for any opposition. And so the following resolutions were drawn up in a confident and emphatic manner. Whereas we are informed by the Chicago press that our city council, through the influence of Mayor Washburn, has appointed a committee of its members to go to Washington for the purpose of influencing Congress to reverse its action with the reference to closing the World's Fair on Sunday. And whereas the Chicago directors have opened headquarters in Washington for the same purpose, notwithstanding the acceptance of $2.5 million appropriation from the Congress on the express conditions that the gate should not be opened to the public on Sunday. And whereas there are 7,000 saloons running open every Sunday, contrary to the state law, therefore be it resolved first, that we enter a most earnest protest against such official action on the part of the mayor and the city council in using such measures in opposition to the action of Congress and spending the people's money in attempting to reverse the very conditions upon which the appropriation of the Congress was received. Resolved that we deprecate and condemn the action of the directors who received the money from Congress upon a condition that the fair should not be open Sunday, a bona fide contract. and are now using all possible effort to influence Congress to set aside said condition. Resolved that in our judgment, it would be more proper for the mayor and city council to close the saloons on Sunday in accordance with the state law than to endeavor to influence Congress to open the exposition Sunday contrary to law. There was applause at the end, and then the chairman of the meeting, Reverend H.H. Axwell, put the resolutions to a vote. To his and other surprise, the A's and the no's seemed equal, with the volume of tone apparently in favor of the latter. The chairman then said that a rising vote would seem to be in order, and he requested all in favor of the resolutions to stand up. The secretary counted 30 on their feet. The rest of the audience, with the exception of four who seemed to have no opinion on the matter, stood up, and the secretary, looking astonished at the evident majority, paid little attention to the counting heads, and declared that there were at least 35 against the resolution, and what seemed strangest was that many of them were women. After a moment of wonder, the chairman said he would like to have some explanation for the action of the majority. So Jones goes on, I was there and gave the reason why we were opposed to the resolutions. The next day in their convention, this thing was called up and quite fully considered. And so I read the report from the Chicago Times of the following day. Gloom pervaded the meeting of the American Sabbath Union yesterday morning. The unexpected setback received at the meeting held at the South Park Methodist Church the evening before had dampened the ardor of the delegates, and only a baker's dozen were in their seats when the presiding officer of that session, Dr. H.H. George of Beaver Falls, Pennsylvania, called the meeting to order. The cause of the depression was the outcome of the meeting the night before. Four mass meetings were held Tuesday night. At the first three, resolutions were adopted in favor of Sunday closing of the World's Fair. At the last, the resolution was defeated. The attendance, it is now claimed to be principally of Adventists. That was the reason of the gloom which pervaded the South Park Church yesterday. The committee appointed to prepare the telegram to Congress reported the following. The National Convention of the American Sabbath Union meeting in this city respectfully request our Congress, and especially the Committee on the World's Fair, that no action be taken to repeal the Sunday closing law. Mass meetings were held in four different parts of the city last night to protest against the repeal of an act dishonorable to Congress and the nation. So what's going on here? What is it that we gather from Jones' presentation here, his 30-minute presentation? And we're not going to have time to go into some of the things I wanted to go into, but we will get there in our other studies.
Well, he appears to, he's going down through the history of this bill that was presented, using laid out arguments that they all presented. And so though for being able to determine the reasoning. So, I mean, he's basically doing some pretty good detective work.
Yeah. So, yeah, and there's a lot to it. I mean, it goes on and on. It's Jones after all. And I'm just trying to. So he's going to appeal to the committee, but mainly his argument is a constitutional one. I mean, there's other reasons that are given because it was a misrepresentation of what the desire of the people was. So I'm not going to read this. There's just a lot of information here. So I'm going to zoom out here. I just want to get to where I want to go. Okay. So to me, I mean, it seems like it would take in a lot more than 30 minutes to. There's some different people's remarks as well. Okay, so. Okay. So this is where we're going to take up on Friday night. We're going to look at his presentation, his third presentation, where he's going to go through some of this as well. But I just want to address, I'm going to go back here a bit and address this World's Fair, the significance of it prophetically as a symbol. So what would we say that this, why is this World's Fair, this World's Columbian Exposition, or known as the Chicago World's Fair, what is this describing symbolically? Let's put it that way.
Well, it's showing everything, the commerce, okay, and the arts.
Yeah.
Isn't that what it said?
Yep. So all the industry and so forth, right? So yeah, this
is all commerce. Yeah,
wouldn't it represent man's inventions?
Okay. Man's inventions.
Well.
Yeah. And there's going to be a bunch of inventions that that we are very familiar with today that were first presented there at this World's Fair.
Right.
It's also the 400th anniversary of Christopher Columbus' arrival to the New World in 1492. Now, what's the significance of that?
400 years.
Okay, so you have 400 years.
I'm asking you. You mean, yeah, are you talking
well,
about?
I'm asking you guys what the well, there's this 400 years. There's Christopher Columbus' arrival to the New World.
Right, and
what are the symbols involved here?
And some of the symbols was Columbus. What didn't we dig out a few of those as well? Dates and stuff Jeff presented.
Yeah. Well, we know that 1492. If we go 1492 on the Gregorian calendar, that's going to be when the Israelites crossed the Jordan. It's 1493 BC on the Julian, but 1492 on the Gregorian, because they have a 0 year. But the New World, I mean, does the New World have any prophetic significance?
Yes.
Okay. Right. So it's a celebration of something that is a prophetic significance. That is the woman fleeing
into the wilderness. Dragon,
right?
Yeah.
Going into the wilderness. Okay.
Yeah.
So now we're going to have at this World Fair this issue of Sunday of the American Constitution. Now, so some interesting little details that we noticed. There's going to be 46 countries that participate in this World Fair. Any significance in the number 46?
Yes, it is. A whole list of them.
A whole list, yeah.
Right. Now, the number of visitors that they have here, it was more than 27 million, but it's 27,300,000. So you see the number 273 there?
Yes.
The number for the Levites.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so we're going to have...
some interesting symbols there.
Yeah, some interesting symbols. Now, it's the dedication of the fairgrounds were held October 21st, 1892. But they're going to actually open to the public May 1st, 1893, which is going to be Passover on the biblical calendar.
Hmm.
And now, October 21, 1892, well, that's one day before October 22nd, but...
Isn't this the fair that that Edison lit up?
Yes. I believe so.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
That was a big thing.
Yeah. And so they're going to have this for 6 months. So May through to the end of October. And
would it have a starting date and closing?
Yeah, so starting
opening, there it is, May 1, 1893, closure October 30th. Yeah.
So it's going to open on Passover. It's the 14th day of the first month on the biblical calendar.
Nice.
Yeah, and then we're going to have, now they also, in addition to recognizing the 400th anniversary of the discovery of the New World by Europeans, the fair also served to show the world that Chicago had risen from the ashes of the Great Chicago Fire, which had destroyed much of the city in 1871.
And what was the story? The cow kicked over the lantern?
Yeah. I'm not sure how true the story is or anything.
It was a story.
It doesn't seem to make sense to me, but.
Right. It's probably more like a still going off.
Okay. Well, so there's lots of interesting things regarding this history. So they talk about all the different things, the architecture, the different buildings that were there, the transportation. There's it's quite a big article in Wikipedia on this. So when it came to electricity, the effort to power the fair with electricity, which became a demonstration piece for Westinghouse Electric and the alternating current system, which they had been developing for many years, took place at the end of what has been called the war of currents between DC and AC, so direct current and alternating current. Westinghouse initially did not put in a bid for to power the fair, but agreed to be the contractor for the local Chicago company that put in a low bid of $510,000 to supply an alternating current-based system. Edison General Electric, which at the time was merging with the Thomson Houston Electric Company to form General Electric, put in $1.72 million bid to power the fair, and it's planned 93,000 incandescent lamps with direct current. So that's what you were referring to, Thomas Edison's.
Yeah, it was the Teslian technology versus the DC.
Right. Yeah. Okay, so there's lots of different things. Things that were first presented: cream of wheat, the brownie, juicy fruit gum, Quaker oats, shredded wheat, Pabst Blue Ribbon, peanut butter, Aunt Jemima pancake mix, Cracker Jack's new recipe, Vienna sausage. I mean, just it becomes a bridge from, in some ways, from that old world to the new world of commercialism. Would people agree with me on that idea?
Yeah, it was really a forefront of mass production.
Yeah. And this is really this idea of the World's Fair. Of course, we could think of the United Nations, right?
That's right.
Yeah. Yeah.
I mean, these are all directions that the world had been changing with all the new technologies, and this Chicago World's Fair becomes this crossroads in America to what we would call modernism. I mean, it doesn't necessarily happen right there, but we do see the world becoming more modern. Now, we live in a postmodern era. But I think it's quite interesting that that we can look at what happened there in 1893. Now, the context here that Jones is presenting, and it's going to take some time to get into it, but he's presenting righteousness by faith, and he's setting down some groundwork to show the contrast between the principles of the world and the principles of the gospel.
Mm.
And that's why the principles of the world can produce things outwardly that look good. But if those principles are followed, they're going to lead to evil, correct?
Yes.
So we need to be sure that we're operating on correct principles. And of course, the principle here, and the reason why he's bringing this up, is because of our need of the Holy Spirit. Because we need the Holy Spirit. Because we need to be able to discern. If we're just using our intellect, we can easily be caught up in what the world is presenting. And this, I think, is the great danger, not just for Seventh-day Adventists, but also for this movement, is that we don't understand the principles that are the foundation of Adventism. The foundation of the gospel. And so things can look good on the outside. People can read Froom's book, The Coming of the Comforter, and think it's all good and conservative. But they don't discern the principles behind it. People can look at what's happening in the political realm and agree with the sentiments around them, not recognizing where they tend, because they don't understand the principles being involved. We can sign petitions that align ourselves with the principles of the world because those petitions seem to stand against something that we also stand against, but it stands against those things for completely different reasons. And we should be able to see, and what we want to see, is how the gospel, the everlasting gospel, the experience that we have been going through as a movement, is to teach us principles that we will be able to stand in that time of test. And it's the Holy Spirit, as Ellen White says, that is our greatest need. And to understand what that means, that is an understanding of the gospel. Any final thoughts as we close this study?
It's personally given me some things to think of.
Okay, Angela first.
Yeah, I was just looking at that pic there, and that showed the Roman soldier or statesman or whoever it was with the crucifix in the left hand and the symbol of Rome in the right hand. I think it was the eagle on top of the globe. So it's like, yeah, imperial conquest using state religion. That's what it looks like to me.
Yeah.
I don't like that symbol at all. Oh, it's a scepter. Okay. I thought it was a crucifix.
Yeah, it's a scepter. But still, see, the symbols of the world really are putting forth the principles of the world.
Yes, I believe that.
Okay, Ron, you had a comment too. What was your comment?
I don't remember.
Okay. Okay, well, let's close with prayer. Dear Father in heaven, we thank you for the Sabbath and for the time that we could have this afternoon, even though it's a topic that we are not that familiar with, this history. Even in my understanding of it, I know that it's weak to understand all of the events that happened. But I do know the principles that you have shown in your word. And we ask, Lord, that we can understand these things as we continue throughout the weeks ahead in this study of righteousness by faith and the history of what happened in Adventism, and where the church has gone wrong, and where we ourselves have also departed from the path. We ask that you can be with each person. May you work in their lives in a powerful way. May your angels watch over each one. We know that there are many people in this movement who are suffering in various ways, facing trials that are heart-wrenching, and we just pray that you can be with them. Thank you for hearing our prayer. In Jesus' name we pray and ask these things. Amen.
Amen.